Okay, now we're back for session 10. This, of course, is the last session of the lecture portion of this. So if you have it by now, you for sure want to be contacting us here at Paola. Probably the best way to contact me is via email, just simply bobh@fortscott.edu. to set up your five-hour lab session, so you can be coming here to Paola, or perhaps you're watching this south of here, you're doing this online, you know, and Fort Scott's closer to you. But still, either way, go ahead and email me here, and I'll arrange, you know, with one of the allied health instructors for you down at Fort Scott also, that you can go and take your 5 hours there. But anyways, be thinking about that, so we can be in contact planning that. So this, like I said, is session number 10. It's meeting the residents' basic needs, basic restorative services. So as we kind of talk about this, some of our terms and definitions that you hear a lot there is like abduction and adduction. Those are just directional terminologies. Adduction means ADD, means moving a body part close to the midline of the body. Abduction, ABD, means moving it away from the midline of the body. Now, when we think about restorative services, okay, there is a definition between rehabilitation and restorative. In generally speaking, rehabilitation, what it is focused on is bringing the person back to the level of functioning that they were at before the illness, before the injury. Restorative, its focus is just to maintain the person at the current level where they are at right now. No more decline, but just hold them stable, hold them stationary at that level. So, in rehabilitation, in restorative, you know, you will be involved in both as a CNA, you know, trying to get the person rehabilitated where physically they can go home, or just restorative to hold them at the level where they're at right now. So we do different types of range of motion. And for the second part of this session, we're going to be going back to our lab and on our mannequin, which we've been calling for years, Molly Ann. Molly Ann's has volunteered to be our demonstration for range of motion, and we'll be talking more about range of motion back there. But there's three basic types of range of motion you do. There's one called active range of motion. Now, in active range of motion, the exercises, the joints are basically put through exercises, a full arc of motion. But the resident does it totally alone, without help. They are totally active. That's why it's called active range of motion. You are just basically maybe giving verbal instructions. Now, the exact opposite is called passive range of motion. This is where the resident is totally passive, not moving at all, like if, say, they were in a coma. And you are doing all the physical work. Now, the one that you basically do the most, of course, is the one in the middle, active assistive range of motion. And that is basically where the exercises where the joint is put through a full arc of motion and is done by the resident with some help basically from you. So it's kind of in the middle. You see in rehabilitation and restorative a bunch of adaptive equipment. Equipment that basically helps the person perform their ADLs, their activities of daily living. Special equipments that help an ill person or disabled person assist them. And that's the same as like an assistive device. One of the things that happens a lot, and it's kind of sad when it happens, is called foot drop. You know, the foot, what it basically does, and sometimes the culprit is simply the sheets are just too tight and they're pulling down on the person's toes terribly, and the foot just does what it describes, foot drop. And a lot of times it will just drop down like that. Like I said, rehabilitation is bringing the person back to the level of functioning they were at prior to the illness, prior to the injury, where restorative literally tries to maintain them at the current level that they're at. Now, as far as guidelines of taking care of people that are on restorative, that are on rehab, you've got to know and understand their diagnosis, their disability. You've got to be familiar with what has happened to them. You've got to be extremely patient, you know, with the resident, with the patient, understanding that, you know, the pain is going to be there with sometimes their movement. They may be hesitant to get up and walk or to do an exercise because of that pain, so you've got to be patient with them. Part of the thing about ADL retraining is basically what it's called. A stroke patient, teaching them how to dress themselves again or how to brush their teeth or brush their hair. You know, for that, you know, step by step, simple instructions is almost imperative. You've probably heard of the acronym KISS, keep it short, stupid. Well, I kind of changed one of the S's to basically say keep it short and simple. A lot of times for your patients, you cannot say brush your teeth. You have to break it down in steps of what they do for the whole process, because they are relearning. That is what ADL retraining is, relearning, retraining in activities of daily living. So that, of course, you have to be patient with them. Maintain a positive attitude at all times. You know, they may have a negative attitude because of what they've gone through. Life has dealt them a hand that has turned them upside down, or a car accident. You know, maybe they were a victim of a car accident. And, you know, all these things, these illnesses, these accidents weren't planned. They weren't hoped for or wished for. So their lives have been turned upside down. So a lot of times they are really negative. So we have to maintain a positive attitude for them and with them, encourage them on, helping them through the frustration. Spend time with them, getting to know them, know their feelings, know their thoughts about this rehab or restorative. What's their motivation? And then use that to basically help you. We had a lady one time in our nursing home. The CNA came up with a brilliant plan. She was not walking and doing the ambulation like she really should. She would rather be in her wheelchair and just wheel up and down the hall and not have to walk because of several things, okay? Well, her granddaughter was getting married in several months to come. And like I said, the CNA came up with a brilliant idea. Went to her, wouldn't you rather walk down the aisle than be rolled down the aisle, you know, of the church in this silly wheelchair? Of course she said yes. She used that as a motivation for this lady to basically start walking. And to make a long story short, the whole facility got in it. We got like a special kind of carpet like they roll down the aisle. We even got some lattice work, kind of like where the couple would stand. We'd even have volunteers that would stand in there sometimes. And that's what we used as the goal. Basically, we made a runway from what we thought would be the back church door all the way up front to where she was going to sit as the grandmother, and that was her goal. And we worked on it week by week, month by month, and by the time it was done, she walked down the aisle. So we spend time learning what their motivation is to basically help them. Not what our motivation is, but basically what their motivation is. Privacy is, of course, an important factor. It protects them should they not accomplish the goal. It protects them from embarrassment. You know, so maintain that privacy. keep your residents as independent as possible. Yes, it's true, you can brush their hair for them a lot faster than they can. But if they will brush their own hair, you know, then let them do what they can do. Because in that, they're going to exercise their fingers, they're going to exercise their wrist, their elbow, and their shoulder. So they're getting a workout, exercise. Plus, on the physiological side, the heart and the lungs are going to get a little bit of a workout also. Plus, emotionally, they're going to have the satisfaction of, I can still do this. I can still brush my hair. So I'm not totally helpless. I can still do something. So encourage them to do as much as they can. And then, of course, positive feedback is especially important for them. So, like I said, we have to promote their independence as much as possible and work with them for that. Allowing them to basically sit at the sink, brush their hair, brush their teeth. We do use many adaptive devices. When you come here for your lab, you know, we'll be talking about the walker, the cane, the crutches, you know, and these adaptive devices, how that they're correctly positioned. Because a lot of people use crutches wrong. They stuff them way up underneath their armpit here, and that cuts off circulation to the lower arm, plus it damages a very important nerve that basically runs right through the axilla. Because what we're going against is basically time. And immobility creates a lot of negative outcomes. A person who's just always sitting there, always laying there. And here's just a few of these things. The skin, of course, is pressure sores, you know, from the pressure of just always laying, always basically sitting. The circulation slows down, so the possibility of blood clots is increased, basically, as a person is just always sitting and never moving around, especially in their legs. The respiratory system slows down, and they have the potential of pneumonia. You know, that's why we turn people so often. You've heard of the adage, a rolling stone gathers no moss, okay? Well, that's the reason why we turn people a minimum of every 2 hours, so that anything in their lungs is not allowed to stay in one position of the lung for very long, to attach to the lung and then to consolidate and grow into a pneumonia. The muscle skeletal system, if they're not used, the person's immobile. Muscles start to shrink, they atrophy, and they start to get these nasty contractures. The nervous system, immobility just brings in plain depression. And then, of course, the endocrine system, weight gain happens. The urinary system is affected basically by immobility, because the person's just sitting there, urine sitting in the bladder, and it starts to stagnate like a pond. You know, and where the pond grows moss and stuff on top of it, well, basically the urine in the bladder, if it gets stagnant, it'll just start to grow bacteria. And then, of course, constipation for the GI system. So many of these systems are basically just literally declining simply because of immobility, and because immobility is such a nasty has a nasty outcome. Now, you'll see many adaptive devices. A lot of times, like simply, you know, the reachers, you kind of seen them, where that has a long reacher, they can pick something off the floor. Plate guards are another adaptive device that basically the hard rim goes around the back of the plate. So many residents, you know, when they ate, they're so used to having their spoon and their butter in the other hand, or a knife, and they push their food out of the spoon with whatever they're holding on their left hand. Well, if their left arm hand has had an injury, it's just laying there. Well, they literally chase their food right off the plate. So the plate guard literally helps it stay on, and they get it a lot easier. There's different wraps that will go around a person's hand, like my watch here. Say if somebody had really bad rheumatoid arthritis, and and this pin pretends it's a spoon. They couldn't grip the spoon like this. You know, they still could move their elbow and their wrist and their shoulder good, but it's just their fingers are rheumatoid arthritis has crippled them. Well, a band can go around the hand like this, the spoon can fit in it just like this, so they still basically can eat that way. So that is another adaptive device that a lot of times people have. There's extenders basically for hairbrushes. A lot of people with their shoulders, they can't bend it. Again, if this is a brush, they can't bend it way up here and brush their hair because the injury or the contraction, whatever, only allows them to bend this much. Well, they have this much space between the brush and their hair. Well, just get an extender for the handle down here, and all of a sudden that person can basically start brushing their own hair again. Like I said, foot drop is where the foot just drops down. And what you'll see today, places will call them space boots, bunny boots, but basically the person's foot will go in there and hold it in the position that's correct so the foot doesn't drop down. I know in home health before, and even in the intensive care unit before, and we're going back a lot of years here, I'm kind of dating myself, but before we had all these space boots and nice sheepskin wrap different bunny boots, we would just simply use high top tennis shoes. The gym shoes that went up the ankle here, and that's what the people would wear in bed so that their foot wouldn't drop down. A lot of people get contractures in their hands, and what you'll see a lot of times is they'll wear a brace that holds the wrist up and it holds the fingers open. We used to like put washcloths in there, and we've been finding out that that actually makes the gripping contracture worse, because if somebody does have like a rolled up washcloth in their hand, the tendency is to grip it more. So what basically happens is the finger contractures can become worse. So we found out, or we're finding out, it's sometimes better to basically wear a splint for the wrist and hold the fingers open and up so that they basically don't do that. Some of the different terms you hear is abduction and adduction. We talked about that already. Extension is where we straighten out a body part, and flexion is where you bend a body part back. Pronation and supination is like turning a joint upward or downward. So supination, like if I turn my hand like this, I've done supination because my joint is upward. Here I have basically done pronation as I've turned my hand downward. Pronation is turning down. Now when you're doing range of motion on your resident, you've got to be careful of pain. We're going to talk about it back there, but you always hold the joint above and below the joint and basically help the person with their different movement. Now, going to the KDHE manual, you know, a lot of times when we're talking about restorative, we talk a lot about restorative nutrition and restorative elimination. A lot of people, you know, because they can't, you're gonna see this a lot, because they can't eat, they can't swallow, they get their nutrition by IV, intravenous. So we've got to know the guidelines of basically taking care of a person who's on an IV, making sure we're not pulling out the tube, making sure that the IV is in there correctly and not infiltrating. Sometimes the IV will infiltrate and it'll basically swell up a certain area. So we've got to observe these IVs well. Some of your people are gonna get nutrition through feeding tubes. The tube goes directly through the abdomen into the stomach. And for that person that can't swallow, the feeding tubes, they get their nutrition that way. Now, if you had a cup of water with no lid on it and laid it down, the cup of water is going to spill out over everywhere. Well, that's the thing you've got to remember with your residents that are getting feeding tubes. They have to be sitting up at least at a 30 degree angle all the time, because their stomach is full of liquid all the time. If they lay flat in bed, just like your cup of water is going to spill out, the contents could come up basically up the esophagus, and as they breathe, they could suck it down into their lungs. So you've got to keep their head, their bed up about 30 to 45 degrees. And at the same time, remember, this head of the bed up is going to put extra pressure on the buttocks. So watch them carefully for sores, you know, down there. Be alert for these people with the feeding tube for nausea and vomiting. As far as restorative elimination, you know, you're going to see a lot of people with catheters. Now, urine, for the most part, if a person does not have a UTI, is sterile inside the human body. Once outside the human body, it grows bacteria in about 20 minutes. So that means the urine in the tubing on the bed is growing bacteria. So if we lift that bag up too high above the level of the bladder, it's going to gravity flow right back into them. And what we're going to be putting back into them is urine-tainted bacterial urine. So we've got to not do that. We've got to be careful how we handle the Foley bag. And for our protection, wear gloves when we empty them, because the urine in that bag has definitely been in there more than 20 minutes. And if we get a little bit splashed in our hand, we could have a microscopic sore in our hand, and the bacteria could basically get in into us. So be careful about the drainage bag. Make sure it's never sitting on the floor. You know, we do put it in a privacy bag, you know, when they're up in the wheelchair, to basically protect their dignity and things like that. Maintains the sterile system of the urinary tubing. Don't break it apart. Don't break sterility. Be careful when you're emptying that urine bag. Don't touch the spigot to anything. Don't get it contaminated. And basically, don't forget your catheter care. You know, it takes about 30 seconds to do catheter care for a resident, but literally just taking hold of that catheter firmly with your one hand and taking just a simple wipe and going down it about 4 to 6 inches one time, one wipe, one swipe, just going down it, throwing it away. And when you go down one time, say you clean the top and the bottom, and get another wipe, you know, and basically do it again on the sides and sides. It just takes a few seconds to basically do this for the residents. And when you come here for your lab, this is another thing we're going to do. But, you know, just reminding you to do this at least once a shift. Clean off those catheters so that, you know, germs and bacteria cannot get up inside the resident and basically cause them to, you know, get urinary tract infections. We've got to, you know, watch out for the residents' diarrhea and urinary incontinence, because BM and urine both have acids in them.